Hey, Anna.
Oh, hey, Sarah. What a nice surprise.
I just wanted to stop by because I'm working on an article for the Washington Post I think you would really like.
Ooh, tell me all about it.
So, did you know that the National Zoo in Washington, D.C. has the world's largest biorepository of exotic animal milk?
Wait, when you say exotic animal milk, do you mean like milk from zebras and dolphins and gorillas?
That is exactly what I mean. Do you want to come see it with me?
Sarah, I have never wanted to do anything more in my entire life. Let's go. Sarah and I met up with Mike Power, an animal scientist at the Smithsonian Conservation Biology Institute and the curator of the Exotic Animal Milk Biorepository.
So why do you study milk?
Well, milk is just a fascinating biochemical substance. I mean, and it defines mammals.
All mammals feed their babies with milk. Humans do it, kangaroos do it. Heck, even the duck-billed platypus and echidna do it. And they hatch their babies from eggs.
They have no nipples, they just have a mammary patch. But it produces milk and it wicks down the hairs and the little babies actually lick the milk right off the hairs.
So they're basically just oozing milk from their chest?
Correct, correct. They're that.
That's awesome.
Those egg-laying mammals may give us a clue to the evolution of milk. You see, when animals with backbones first started coming up onto land, they needed a way to keep their eggs from drying out. Some animals developed hardened shells that keep moisture in, but the lineage that led to mammals may have done something different.
Probably one of the earliest functions of milk simply is to deliver water.
Huh.
And to deliver water to eggs.
Ancient relatives of mammals evolved the modified sweat glands we know as mammary glands, probably to secrete a watery substance onto their eggs. And since moisture tends to lure bacteria and fungus, antimicrobial properties eventually got added to the milk too.
Now those eggs hatch. They have little tiny babies, little hatchlings. Can they go and find water right away? Can
Probably
they eat the
not.
Diet that the mother's eating? No.
So hatchlings started lapping up this early milk.
Yeah.
And as time went on, other molecules got added. These are proteins, sugars, fats, and minerals like calcium and phosphorus. But every mammal's milk is different, and the composition is related to the animal's lifestyle. For example, in hooded seals, moms only nurse for 4 days, so their milk is packed with fat to help their babies bulk up quickly. Carnivores like lions and tigers eat tons of protein, so there's lots of it in their milk. And then there's the armadillo.
What does a baby armadillo grow that is incredibly unique?
It's sort of shell.
It is a shell. It's a bone. It's calcium and phosphorus you need, okay? So not surprisingly, through lactation, the mineral content of armadillo milk actually gets higher than the sugar content.
Wow.
Oh, interesting. This huge diversity in the composition of animal milks is why the zoo has its exotic milk repository. Scientists want to understand what's in each mammal's milk, both because they might find new useful compounds and because the results could have life or death implications for animals in the zoo's care.
Cincinnati Zoo, about a year or so ago, had a baby Fiona, the hippo, was born. She was born premature. She couldn't stand on her feet, so they had to hand rear that animal.
Mike and his colleagues analyzed hippo milk to help the Cincinnati Zoo develop a formula for Fiona. And now she's a star on the internet.
Yes, she is.
Certain animals at the National Zoo are actually trained to donate milk for long-term studies. Mother's milk changes over time, so what's good for an infant might not work for an older baby. One such animal is Batang the orangutan. She's still breastfeeding her baby Red and lets her keeper take a small sample of her milk each week in exchange for some tasty snacks. Though sometimes Batang doesn't feel like it or she doesn't have that much milk to give. And that's okay too.
So what do we learn about people and keeping us healthy by comparing human milk to all these other different kinds of milk?
The main differences that I see in human milk from other milks, and certainly the milks of our closely related species, is on the immunological side. Huge differences on the immunological side.
Compared to other primates, human milk has way more antibodies in it. Those are proteins that fight infections. Through milk, our mothers essentially pass on their immune system's knowledge to us. On top of that, there are special types of sugars in human milk that don't feed the baby, but feed the good bacteria that keep the baby healthy.
We went through a period of time in our history where we were living in incredibly pathogen-high environments. Start thinking about it. First of all, we start hunting. So we're killing other animals and eating meat. All right, that's bringing pathogens in. Now we start occupying the same hunting camps over and over again. Well, we're starting to concentrate where we're living. We actually are being successful. So the number of people is increasing. More ways to get sick.
Yeah.
When you're in that high pathogen environment without modern sanitation and modern medicine, who dies? Well, your old people and your little babies.
Yeah.
And you see that in the milk and it makes sense and you look back in history.
Milk is like our superpower.
Yes. There you go. Well said. You must write for a living.
If you want to know more about the science of milk and why we should study it, check out Sarah Kaplan's article in the Washington Post.
And if you like Science Magic Show, hit that subscribe button.
Hooray!
Science Magic Show, Science Magic Show, Science Magic Show.